Chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, in deathless past, in unrecorded time. I think time was not there. God created the heavens and the earth. Time came into being when God made the sun and the moon to tell us about days and weeks and months and years. When there was no time, so there's no record. The period passed, you cannot talk about it. Too distant away, we cannot talk about it. God created the heaven and the earth. The word God here in the original, as called us, is a plural word. It's a plural word, which means more than one person. You get the plural word understood when you come to verse 26. It says, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Can you see plurality of the first verse in the Bible, of the first great word in the Bible, God? That word is a plural word expressed in verse 26. Lay us. It means more than one person was involved in creation. More than one person was involved in the creation. But in case you think these persons that make up God are separate gods, the scripture quickly solves the problem at the beginning by telling you that no, it's one person actually. It's a unity. It's actually one person. More than one personalities, but actually it's one person in verse 27. So, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, created him, male and female, created he, them, so that you don't get confused that there are many gods who do this. No, it's one God. The three personalities form one God. Three separate personalities that can talk to each other because he had laid us. One was speaking. But actually, that's one God. See the emphasis in the pronoun he in verse 27. So God, the person that make up God, created man. Who are they? Is one person in his image. His own image, created him, not able to corrupt. And that was the man God took to cause the promise of Genesis to be fulfilled in him. But through Noah, that son, that seed of the woman, would be born into the world to combat with the devil and get him out of control of mankind. Get him out of oppression, position, authority over mankind. So, through Noah, it continued. Then, as you saw, you see the story, the whole world was destroyed. And only Noah and his children were saved. And they began for creation again to replenish the earth. Then, as time went on, the Lord now decided to pick another man, one of the great grandsons of Noah, by whom the seed of the woman will be born into the world for human salvation. for satanic destruction. Or Satan's destruction. Who was that man? That man was called Abraham. Everybody say Abraham. Now, let's look at the book of Genesis, chapter 12. We'll read from verse 1 to verse 4. Now, the Lord had said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee, and I will make of thee a great nation. And I will bless thee, and make thy name great. And thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. The seed of the woman shall come through Abraham. Is it for children of Abraham alone? He said, all families of the earth. He is coming for all mankind. Right from the beginning, even before there was a nation called Israel, the promise of God was to save all families of the earth, all tribes of the earth, all nations of the earth. That was divine plan. Indeed, shall all families of the earth be blessed. But he was still mentioning that seed. Look at it in Genesis 22. Genesis chapter 22 in verse 15 to verse 18. And the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time and said, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing, and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven, and as the sun that which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. I want you to see the singularity there. Thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. In chapter 12, all the families of the earth. Now he made it clear, all the nations of the earth. By who? By thy seed, not seeds. If you were referring to all children, you would have put them seeds, because the word seed has plurality. Seed is a single grain. Seeds are more than one. So, but here, he was referring, that seed of the woman shall pass through the house of Abraham and come for world blessing, world salvation. That is the promise. And this promise made in the generation of Abraham. One shall be born, the seed that shall fulfill what was promised in Genesis for human salvation and deliverance from Satan and sin. Now, who took over this promise? We see Isaac took over this promise. After Abraham, the promise went to Isaac. In Genesis chapter 21, verse 12. Genesis 21, verse 12. But let's start it from verse 8. And the child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast the same day that Isaac was weaned. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, which was Ishmael, which she had borne unto Abraham, mocking. Wherefore she said unto Abraham, cast out this born woman and her son, For the son of this born woman, Ishmael, shall not be here with my son, even with Isaac. And the thing was very grievous in Abraham's sight because of his son, Ishmael. And God said unto Abraham, let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the lad and because of thy born woman. In all that Sarah had said unto thee, hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Is it an Ishmael?
No.
That seed that promised in the garden shall be coming through Isaac. So allow Ishmael to go, as Sarah is saying, so that he does not come to strive with Isaac, because the Savior of the world will be coming from Isaac. Now, from Isaac, it moved to Jacob. In Genesis 25, verse 21. Genesis 25, verse 21. And because, okay, let me start from verse 20. And Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel, the Syrian of Padan Aram, the sister to Laban the Syrian. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren. And the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. Verse 22. Verse 22 and 23. And the children struggled together within her. And she said, if it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord. Verse 23. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy borders. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. Now let's continue. And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red all over night, and had hairy garment. And they called his name Esau. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob. And Isaac was threescore years old when she bare them. 60 years old was Isaac when she gave birth to Esau and Jacob. Esau was the firstborn. Jacob was the secondborn. And what did the word say? The elder shall serve the younger. The choice has gone to the younger. The choice of the seed that was coming from Noah, Abraham, Isaac, had gone to who?
Jacob.
So, from Jacob, the line continued. It was now going to Judah. Because Jacob gave birth to 12 children. And Judah was the number four child. And the number four child was Joseph. But before we go to that, I want you to see the scenario by which the name Jacob changed to Israel. Jacob, a man, was given a name. What's that name? Israel, a nation. Look at it in Genesis chapter 22, verse 27 and 28. Genesis 32, verse 27. And he said unto him, what is thy name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with me, and has prevailed. By implication, you would have thought that the name Jacob would disappear. No, as an individual, that name Jacob remained. But Because of the nation that shall be established through Jacob, the Lord said, your name shall be called Israel. If that Israel now becomes a nation, the nation shall bear that name Israel. And they are all the sons of Jacob. Amen?
Amen.
So now, we have seen it, how the name of the nation Israel came out by God himself. If you're feeling sleepy, go and stand outside there. You stand behind there. Now, we move forward. The Messiah was to come through Judah. Look at it in Genesis chapter 49, verse 10. Genesis chapter 49, verse 10. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. The staff of authority and kingship of Israel and of course of the whole world shall not depart from the tribe of Judah. The tribe of Judah is the chosen tribe, and all nations that occur is many people. People come to pilgrimage here in Jerusalem, in Israel. Is that so? They come to this land, they go to various other communities in this land, in this nation. They come for pilgrimage, but their eyes are blind, many of them, to what they come to do. When their eyes open, many would be born again in when they come to pilgrimage to this nation. Many would have been born again. What do I say of two people who sleep here? You sleep in the nation of Israel here. Can you raise up your hand? You are in here from Tel Aviv. Raise up your hand. Okay, you see them now. Are there people outside who have not come in here that are in Tel Aviv? It's a clear question. And they are not born again. Have they known what formed this nation? Had they known the personality behind this nation, they would have surrendered to Jesus. And this nation would have been the gate of heaven for them. But they didn't know. The prophet told them concerning this seed of the woman that will be coming into the world through Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Judah, that he was God himself. Look at it in the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verse 6 and verse 7. Isaiah, chapter 9, verse 6 and verse 7, the Bible says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Verse 7. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. So here it is described the man, the personality that shall land in Israel as a child, then a son. As a child, then a son. As a child, he was born a babe. When he was born, the shepherds came from the field and said, angel appeared to us and said, unto you this day is born in the house of David, which was Bethlehem, a Savior, which is who? Christ, the Lord himself, the Lord of the universe, has come. Because it is going to be in the lineage of David, he came in Bethlehem. For David's village was Bethlehem. to show that he was the lineage of David after the flesh. He was born in Bethlehem. But that person is Christ, the seed of the woman, who is the Lord himself. Amen? That child that was born unto us a child is born in Bethlehem. That child was Christ, the seed of the woman promised in the garden. And who is that seed? The Lord himself. Here it was described, his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. He is the Father of creation, the originator of creation. He is the owner of creation. The peace of mankind depends on him. The peace of the universe depends on him. He is the reason for peace in heaven. Peace among the angels. Peace among the fish in the sea. Peace among the animals in the forest. He is the Prince of Peace. The owner of peace. The administrator of peace in the universe. The Mighty God. Give a clap of praise. Glory to his name. That's him. That's him. Let all pilgrims know that when you come to Jerusalem, you come to the nation of Israel for pilgrimage, you are coming to see where God came to and stayed for 33 and a half years. If this will be your mind, if your mind is shaped this way, when they showed you this was his grave, this was his cross, this was where this was where he was born, this is the manger, you will be shaking and trembling. You will be worshiping and blessing the Mighty God. If you know this, you will be dwelling in this nation with care, with fear, and say, I will dwell in this nation with the fear of the Lord, because upon all the earth, this is where the God of creation chose to be. He came here. His presence was felt here. His footprint was seen here. You will fear every day. You will live in holiness every day. You will live in worship every day. But till this time, their eyes are blind. Their ears are dull of hearing. They play hypocrisy. They reject the whole thing. It's because they've not understood. Yes, that's what we are saying. That's what we want you to understand. What did he really come to do? The Bible showed us that he came to save man and rule over them, to save men from sin and Satan, and rule over them forever after the throne of David. Because the Lord had promised David that his kingdom would be established over Israel forever. That's what the Lord has said. 2 Samuel chapter 7. His kingdom would be established over Israel forever. That's a wonderful promise that the Lord gave unto David. And David was surprised. David was surprised. Yes. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, I read verse 10. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may dwell in a place of their own, and move no more. Neither shall the children of wickedness afflict them anymore as before time. And as since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel, and have caused thee to rest from all thine enemies. Also, the Lord telleth thee that he will meet thee and house, and when thy days be fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee. I want you to know he's talking about Jesus back again to the seed of the woman that is coming after the throne of David. I will set up thy seed after thee. which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom, and he shall build an house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom. How long?
Forever.
Is that Solomon? Solomon was just a temporal human fulfillment, but the real person was Jesus, the seed. The seed of the woman. The seed which shall be God himself. That is why the word of God is telling us that he came after the throne of his father David. Look at it in the book of Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. The Bible tells us about the birth of Jesus. Verse 18. Luke chapter 1, verse 30. Downward. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name who?
Jesus.
He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob. How long?
Forever.
And of his kingdom there shall be no end. That's what he did. That's why Jesus came to this man. It's God himself. It's a way God planned in human form to relate with his people. To relate with them as man so they can see him as they cannot see the Father physically. For no man can see God and live because of the glory of God. But see, Jesus, the image, the express image of God, has taken the form of a man, and by that flesh in him, he covered the glory so that man cannot see him. He's still God. He's the second person of the Godhead, big God, the Creator. Then he can now rule man directly by himself forever. And he planned that he shall be after this, the throne of David. He shall be called the Son of David as a human being. That's the plan. That's why he came there. That's why Jesus came to Israel. That's where he lived. That's what brought him to save man and rule man. Forever. Yes. Now, Jesus was born. In his birth, heaven announced to the earth that he was king of the Jews. But through the Jews, he would get the whole world and be king of kings and Lord. Look at it in the book of Matthew, chapter 2. Matthew, chapter 2. I read verse 1. Matthew 2, verse 1. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod, the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he that is born, King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the heart and disbelief. What a great mockery. Mockery of religion? Not to talk about those who say, hey, Jesus is my, our uncle, he is my brother, and you are a sinner, and you are playing with the fact that you are an Israelite. You're playing with that privilege. You will cry in hell. Hellfire. You will cry and regret that you were an Israelite. And God happened to the Creator God who came and suffered on earth. You will cry. You will regret. Better you were born outside in the outside over there, in the inside the forest, and never ever happened to a called Israel. That you were an Israelite and played with the privilege that God came to the earth. See what the Bible tells us in John chapter 1, verse 10 and verse 11. John chapter 1, verse 10 and 11. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. That's Jesus. That Jesus you're mocking at said the world was made by him. That Jesus you're mocking at is saying that he fought you. You are his own. All people, all nation, but that you rejected him. That is it. That's what it means. Pity these people. Their end is terrible. Pity the Israelites. Their end is terrible. For they shall not see his face. They cannot, all of them, because they disbelieve their God. Our God. Yes. That's what went on. Exactly. Now, he came among the Jews to use the Jews to bring other nations to his kingship and righteousness. But the Jews rejected him. They rejected his lordship and killed him after the flesh. Acts chapter 2, verse 24. Acts chapter 2, verse 24 and 36. Verse 24 and 36 of Acts chapter 2. The Bible tells us, whom God hath raised up, having, okay, let's read from verse 22. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you, the seed of the woman, by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determined counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holding of death. It was not possible. How can life die? How can life die? But it was the predetermined counsel of God. So it is not really by your power. God planned that he would take on human flesh, because all men must die. More men die, not necessarily by old age. So it is by that plan that you will kill him because of your wickedness. And actually you did it. You actually did it. But God raised him from the dead. And he's talking about the Son after the flesh. God the Father raised him from the dead. Why? Death cannot keep God in it. He is God. He is the Lord. Death cannot keep God inside it. So he rose back to life again in verse 36. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made the same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. That man Jesus that he looked at him as common, he is the Lord of all. He is the seed of the woman to bruise the head of the devil to set mankind free from him. God has declared himself, and that is true. Unto us a child was born, unto us a son was given. The government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. He is like, looking at that Jesus, see how he was described in 1 John chapter 1. 1 John chapter 1 from verse 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. He was called the Word. What is that? The Word of Life. For the life was manifested. He is life that came, that appeared to the earth. Eternal life. When you have that, God does not die. He lives forever. It is that God that appeared in the person of Jesus. For the life was manifested. And we have seen it. And bear witness. And show you that eternal life. Jesus is that eternal life. It was the vehicle of eternal life he came to the earth with, to carry people to eternal life. The vehicle of eternal life is what Jesus brought to the earth so that he could carry as many as will enter into eternal life. As many who believe, who are dead now, are inside that vehicle of eternal life. And coming, live forever. Yes. We bear witness and show you that eternal life, which was with the Father. He is Jesus, with the Word of life. He is Jesus, Emmanuel. He is the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Father of creation. Yet, I was manifesting unto us that which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. If we agree, Holy Ghost will be in us and bring us to this other two personality. Praise the Lord. So that's what the Word of God is speaking unto us. Very important. And in chapter 4, verse 8 to 12, Acts of Apostles, chapter 4, verse 8 to verse 12. It was also declared there Jesus Christ as the Lord of his life, and speak to him in righteousness and holiness, shall go to heaven, as well as any of any other tribe that would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and speak to him in righteousness and holiness, shall also make it to heaven. There's no difference. Why? Sin has happened to all. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Whether Jew or Gentile, all are like Israel. And so all must believe to be saved. The gospel, therefore, is as much to the nations of the world as it is to Israel in the present time. That's what the Word of God is revealing unto us. Yes. For Jesus Christ now, having told them, you won't see me again until you will say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. When he resurrected, he declared the whole world open for the gospel. He first had wanted to start from Israel and then sent Israel to the world to gather the world to himself. But now, since they have rejected, he declared the door open. In Mark chapter 16, Mark chapter 16, verse 15 to 16. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned, Jew and Gentile alike. The gospel now shall be preached to every creature, you and them. The mercy unto eternal life is through the gospel of Jesus. And they must come to it to be saved. As you must come to it to be saved. You who are of the Gentile nation. That's the mind of God. That's the truth revealed. Yes. All unbelievers, he that believeth not shall be damned. All unbelievers among the Israel shall go to hellfire. Those who believe will go to heaven. Satan has put the Israelites in great iniquities. As we can see that the nation is becoming Sodom and Gomorrah. The Lord shall soon pass them through the great tribulation. He shall soon pass them through fire to be purified in the furnace of fire. And that is the great tribulation through the Antichrist. It shall soon happen. There's already a shaking in the woods in the valley. Son of man, shall these bones live? He took me around a valley full of dead bones. As you can see them now, dead bones. A miracle is coming. I say a miracle is coming.
Amen.
This nation that you see these atrocities and sins, in a moment, if at all this kind of sin shall be wiped out, you will see Zionists rise up in Israel. You will see the glory of the Lord in Israel. You will see the power of God in Israel. You will see mighty wonders among the Israelites, because their God shall come back the second time. At that time, all Israel shall be saved. But by before day, he shall pass them through the furnace of fire, by the great tribulation, and many shall die. The few that remain, one third, shall cry out and say, we now repent. Messiah, you came, we didn't know. Now come and save us from the Antichrist. That will now bring Jesus a second time. Then he shall be coming, not born in a manger anymore. He shall be coming with bright light in the sky. He shall be coming with great glory. Angels shall be accompanying him. We shall accompany him with great glory. We shall be descending to deliver Israel from the Antichrist, and then to establish this rule of Christ for 1,000 years. Millennia reign. Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
I said Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
All those nations that mocked him, they shall seek him and be well and move. I said, hey, what shall we do? But the Lord is coming. He is now coming as the God of heaven. He will be returning as the creator of the universe. All eyes shall see him and know it and recognize it, for Satan shall flee away. Satan shall not be there anymore, because they have bound him and cast him into the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. So very soon it will start. Have you not heard the news? It has started already. You heard that Trump declared Jerusalem to be the headquarters of Israel. Have you heard?
Yes,
the temple will soon be built. And that is the temple that the Antichrist will come and claim. This thing I am saying is in few years. This thing I am saying is in few years. You have been in the room all this while. You didn't know that the cloud is thick with cloud. The sky is thick with cloud. Get out of your room of ignorance and look up to the sky. Great rain is coming and you're not aware. Great rain. A great change is coming. A great change is coming upon the universe, and you are not aware. Because you have been in a room. You have been covered in a room of ignorance, room of sin, of Israel. And what shall take over? Lord, help me to win them. I win them for you. At least individuals of them shall be saved. But as for a whole nation, no. No. For a whole nation, no. But individuals shall be saved. Labor for individuals. Labor. Tell the Lord to help you. You will labor. Who will tell them? Who will tell them that Jesus died for sinful men? Who will tell them? Who will tell them that he's coming back? Answer. He's coming back again. Tell yourself, Jesus died for you. You are in the land where blood was shed, and that is the blood of the Son of God. Let that blood cleanse you. Let that blood change you. Take away sin from your life. Thank you, Jesus. Open your mouth and pray. Speak out your words as people who have had a new thing. And repent of your sins. Tell the Lord to save you from your sins. Boy, stand up upon your feet.
If you must go.